Thank you for standing by. As a reminder, if you'd like to ask a question, you will need to press star one. We'd like to welcome you to the Bryant Jennings versus Luis Ortiz conference call. This is Hilda, and I will be your operator for today. At this time, all participants are in a listen-only mode. We will conduct a question-and-answer session later in the session. Please note that this conference is being recorded. I will now like to turn the call over to Mr. Eric Gomez, Vice President of Golden Boy Promotions. Mr. Gomez, you may begin.
Thank you very much. Thank you. I want to thank everybody that's on the call for being on this official call here to announce our December 19th showdown between Bryant Bye-Bye Jennings and Luis, the real King Kong Ortiz. The heavyweight division is starting to heat up, and a big reason will be on December 19th. We're happy to announce this fight. It's going to be a 12-round clash for the WBA interim heavyweight title, and it will be at Turning Stone Casino in Verona, New York. This fight is presented by Golden Boy Promotions and in association with Gary Shaw Productions. The action-packed night will be televised live on HBO Boxing After Dark. It begins at 10:15 p.m. Eastern and Pacific. And I just want to give a big thank you to HBO, who obviously has done a great, great job this year in boxing, and by far is the best network for boxing. Tickets. Tickets for this event are on sale now, and they're starting as low as $25, $35, and $60 for ringside. You know, it's a great night of boxing, and obviously $60 for ringside is a great price. You don't want to miss it. Tickets are going to be available at the Turning Stone Resort box office by calling 315-361-7469, or you can always go online at Ticketmaster.com. As I said, it's going to be at Turning Stone. We did a show earlier this year at Turning Stone. They're great partners, and we're happy to be there again. They're hosting the event. It's actually called the Oneida Nations Turning Stone Resort Casino. And, you know, it's a premier destination, and obviously they've been doing a lot of boxing lately, so we want to thank them for all their support and for being great partners. And on today's call, you'll hear from both teams. You'll hear from Team Jennings and Team Ortiz, and you can ask them questions about their clash coming on December 19th. With that, I want to move now to introduce you to Team Ortiz. And we want to start with his trainer, Herman Caicedo, who's done a great job with Luis. He's undefeated, and obviously with this fight here, you know, it's going to be a big step up for him, and, you know, it's going to get him closer to bigger, better fights. So, Herman, if you could say a few words, please.
Sure. Thank you for having me on. I'm very excited for the 19th of December. For the fight, we've been working very, very hard, you know, for the past year and a half, preparing for this, you know, step-up fight, as you said. And you know, I know that Luis is gonna, you know, show the world exactly why they call him King Kong.
That's great. Thank you, Herman. Thank you very much. And now, with a record of 23-0, 20 knockouts, he's unbeaten. Obviously, he's a southpaw, very dangerous fighter. He has some pretty impressive wins over Monty Barrett and obviously Byron Poley. And just happy to be back in the hunt and back on HBO. So please welcome, and I'll have him say a few words, Luis, the real King Kong Ortiz. Luis?
Sí, gracias por tenerme aquí en la entrevista. Usted sabe, es agradecido por esta oportunidad que Dios nos ha dado a mí y al team de nosotros por pelear.
Perfect. Okay, to translate will be his manager, Jay. Jay?
Hey, how you doing, guys? Luis, I'd like to thank the Golden Boy team and HBO and everyone who supported him to give him a chance to prove himself finally to the world of
you know, what he deserves. And he wants to thank God also.
That's great. Thank you. Thank you very much, Jay and Luis. With that, we can open it up for questions.
Thank you. As a reminder, if you'd like to ask a question, please press star 1. We have a question from Dan Rafael from ESPN.
Thank you very much. Eric, Jennings is not on the call yet, correct? Just Luis right now?
No, I don't think so. I don't know if they're listening or not, but he'll be on.
Okay, so I can just ask Luis our question. My question for Luis is, you know, he won his title against Vidondo, his interim title in October, against an opponent who most people had never heard of. You know, most people would say, hey, not a big fight. He's got that belt, but now he's fighting Jennings, who was considered a much more notable, significant contender. Will he feel more like he's accomplished something by beating a known name like Jennings, who went 12 with Klitschko, compared to knocking out Vidondo, who was basically an unknown fighter?
Yes. He says 100% that he's going to feel a lot more accomplished beating somebody like Jennings, who has a real record, finally.
My other question then for him is, it was an interesting matchup just on its own, forgetting about what else was going around in the division, because, you know, Luis and Jennings, you know, two good fighters, obviously, in the heavyweight division. But given what happened last weekend with Fury pulling the upset against Vladimir Klitschko, it sort of opens up and makes a lot of other things possible in the heavyweight division, because one fighter does not just have an ironclad hold on it like Klitschko had for so many years. So I'd like to know from Luis what he thinks about where the heavyweight division is now and where he fits into it now that it really seems to be wide open, at least for the time being, with Klitschko not the champion.
All right. Ahora que Vladimir perdió la faja a Tyson Fury, ¿cómo tú ves la división de peso completo? ¿Y cómo tú ves que tú quepa ahí en esa división?
Todo aquí que sabe que yo tengo mi talento y que llegué aquí a los Estados Unidos y que me acuerdo con todas las veces, vengo a buscar lo más grande de la división.
He says it fits for him perfectly that people that know boxing know what's coming to the table. They know he's coming for that number one spot. He didn't come over here from Cuba to let sit back and not work.
Very good.
So
all right, Luis, thank you very much.
Yeah, take that belt.
Oh, I'm sorry. Say that last part again.
It leaves him a great opportunity to come and get the belt.
He's a power
puncher boxer. Luis's record, if you really look at it, the only reason the two other knockouts ain't there is because those people disqualified themselves. Or if not, it'll be 23 and 22.
Gotcha. All right, appreciate your time. Look forward to seeing you guys up in Verona. Thank you.
Thank you, Dan.
Thank you, Dan.
Our next question comes from John Gatling from the New Yorker Examiner.
Yeah, what I wanted to ask Luis is, he's an older heavyweight. He's an accomplished, obviously, in the Cuban system. But does he feel, after having been around so long, that this is the most important fight of his career? I know he's faced competition comparable to Jennings before, but given the stage that he's on, is this the most important fight of his career?
Quiero saber si estando tanto tiempo con el boxeo, si esta es la pelea que tú crees en tu corazón la más importante de tu carrera.
Para mí todas son importantes, pero esta es importante.
He said yes, to him every fight has been important, but yes, this is the most important fight.
Does he expect to stop Jennings?
Do you expect to stop
Jennings?
Yes. Hell yes.
Wow, okay. That's all of that.
He says anybody who comes to him, he's coming to stop him. He's a boxer puncher. He's a threat. He knows it. When he says about the age, he says that's what they said about Mayweather. And the young guys can't beat Mayweather. He's still faster than them and much more skilled.
Thank you. Our next question comes from Glenn Irby from Black Sport Online.
Hi, Luis. Do you think that the win over Jennings will put you in line for a shot against Wilder or Fury?
What was that? That question was to me. We can't hear today.
Glenn, can you speak a little bit louder, please?
Yes, I was asking Luis if he felt a win over Jennings would put him in line for a showdown with Deontay Wilder or Tyson Fury.
¿Tú crees que ganándole a Jennings te ponga la línea ya para Tyson Fury or what?
Yeah,
he said yes. He thinks that Savage should put him ready for anybody. Hello?
Thank you, Luis.
Did you hear me? Oh, he said that.
Oh, thank you.
Yes, I heard.
Thank you. And the next question comes from Albert Baker from Instant Boxing.
Yeah, Luis, you're 36 now. Do you feel like there's a sense of urgency? And in the event you were to lose to Jennings, do you feel like that might be the end for you?
Tengo 36 años, ¿tú crees que hay apuro? Y en caso que se pierda, si todavía hay chance. The age, he doesn't see it. Because he's been in boxing without getting hit. He's got speed and movement. And to lose, he's not thinking about that. That's not in his mind.
Okay. Okay, and last, Luis, you're a big, charismatic heavyweight. You have a kind of a large presence about you with a lot of energy. Are we going to see you learn English to start winning over those American fans in what looks like is going to be a new resurgence of the heavyweight division with the dethroning of Klitschko recently?
Yeah, I try it every day. He said yes, he's trying every day, learning English every day.
Okay, thank you.
All right,
thank you.
The next question comes from Steven Calderon from The Boxing Voice.
Thank you. Good afternoon, everybody. Louis, your last fight went only 3 rounds. In 2012 was the last time you went over 4 rounds. Are you concerned that your stamina won't be adept to go into the later rounds where Jennings has experience at 10 and 12 rounds?
He's coming to do his job. He doesn't know what rounds it'll ever be. He's coming to do his job. Nobody could ever calculate really what rounds, because it's up to Jennings. It's up to Jennings. If he wants to come fight, he'll come run. That'll determine the fight. If Jennings tells you if he's coming to fight, then it won't go many rounds. If he's coming to box and move and run. As far as stamina, he does.
Okay, great. Thank you.
Jay, can you repeat that answer one more time? We had a hard time hearing you.
That as far as his stamina, Lewis says he does 16, 17 rounds nonstop in his sparring, so stamina is not an issue. As far as what stoppage he could give him, and what time we can't determine because it's up to the opponent. I'm going to fight. I'm going to be boxing up.
Okay, thank you. And also one quick question for the trainer. Herman, how do you train Louis for a fighter like Jennings? Do you have to do anything different to adapt to Jennings' style, or is it just training as usual?
As far as the conditioning is concerned and the preparation for, you know, teaching a fighter that full on at this high level. With being an older fighter, I take into consideration some things, you know, for the body and giving it the proper rest, et cetera, that you wouldn't with a younger fighter. But that's really the only difference in conditioning. As far as the strategy is concerned, each fight has its own strategy. Every fighter is a little bit different. The really nice thing about working with a fighter like Lewis, who understands the art of boxing, he's been in the ring since he was 6 years old, there's not a square inch in that ring that he doesn't understand and can't completely manipulate to, you know, favor him. So, you know, if you see the style, he can adapt to it immediately, even before he gets back into the corner when we're sparring. I've definitely given him all kinds of styles, and in his career, he's seen them all also. So it's really just, you know, like I said a minute ago, is really just preparing condition to make sure that he can do what he does best naturally for the 12 rounds. And you know, there are some things that we talked about statistically and that Jennings does do over and over. And then there's some, you know, game plan points that we've done that, yeah, there is a little bit of difference in this fight and the magnitude of the fight. So, yeah, I mean, everything's more intense. Everything's more dialed in. And, you know, come December 19th, I think he's going to show the world, as I'm sure Jennings is coming to show the world as well. It'll be a great fight.
All right. Thank you very much, guys. Good luck.
Yeah, thank you for asking.
As a reminder, if you'd like to ask a question, please press star 1 on your touchtone phone. The next question comes from Diego Morilla from ringtv.com.
Hello, everybody. Thank you for taking the time for the call. I'm going to ask the question in English first and then in Spanish for Luis. It's about his role as the flag bearer of the Cuban heavyweight boxing and the possibility of him becoming the best or the most recognized heavyweight in Cuban history. Luis, te quería preguntar básicamente sobre la posibilidad de que te transformes en campeón mundial de pesos pesados. Completaría una tarea de muchísimos años de un linaje de boxeo cubano en el peso pesado realmente extraordinario, con nombres como Félix Sabón, Teófilo Stevenson y demás, y tú llegarías a ser el abanderado de ese movimiento, de ese linaje tan grande. ¿Cómo pesa esto en tu motivación, en tu motivación diaria y en tu mentalidad para esta pelea y para las que vienen con el título mundial?
Claro, yo tengo mi corazón estoy listo y preparado físico y mentalmente para esta pelea y tengo el talento que he entrenado desde niño y que me ha dado mi entrenador aquí, y estoy 100% para demostrarle al mundo que King Kong va a ser el campeón del mundo. Tiene va a ser el campeón del mundo.
Y para okay, antes, ya te vi, sí, go ahead, yes.
Jay, can you translate that?
They asked him about if he has, or if he could be, the first heavyweight champion Cuba's ever seen in history, which he's the first interim champion Cuba's ever had in history. And he says, of course, he does it from the heart. He does it for Cuba. He does it for himself. That he thinks he could be, and he is going to be that guy to do that for Cuba. For Cuba.
All right, thank you, guys. Gracias, Luis.
Thank you. Gracias. Thank you.
We have a question from Daniel Olea from Zona Deportiva.
Buenas tardes a todos. Daniel Olea de Los Ángeles. Luis, me gustaría preguntarte qué habilidades boxísticas tiene Luis Ortiz para en un futuro poder enfrentar y derrotar a gente como Tyson Fury o quizás a Deontay Wilder.
El boxeo, la experiencia y lo que he aprendido cada día en el gimnasio. Todo está en el corazón. Esto es todo, la relación, el gimnasio lo dice todo. Muchos entrenan, pero no tienen la experiencia suficiente y el corazón para llevar una pelea.
Jay, can you go ahead and translate that?
Okay, they asked him if he thinks he has and what it takes to be able to beat the likes of guys like Tyson Fury and Wilder. And he says, of course. Of course, that's what he does. He, with his training, with his determination, with his camp, and most importantly, with his heart, he thinks he's going to be unstoppable.
Y mi segunda y última pregunta sería para ti, Luis. ¿Consideras que el hecho de que, pues viendo que la época de los Klitschko se está acabando, está llegando a su fin, bueno para la división de los pesos completos resucitarla con gente nueva como Fury, como quizás tú, u otros peleadores como nuevos campeones?
Claro, claro, claro. Ya, esta es otra época, estamos ready, por lo menos, yo estoy ready para eso. Quiero traer los cinturones para el United States. Hello?
Go ahead and translate that as well, Jay. Thank you.
Okay, he says that he's more than ready and able to do what he has to do. And more importantly, he wants to bring the belts back here to the United States.
I'm done. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. And we have a question from Brick Seekins from Breacher Report.
Oh, yeah, this is a question, I guess, for anybody generally, but Luis especially. I'm wondering, with the political situation making some big changes in the last year or so between Cuba and U.S., is there any thought at this point, or any hopes at least, starting to develop that a guy like, you know, Luis could fight in Cuba? Because I know it seems like the Cubans are sort of at a disadvantage for audience pull since they've come over. They're unquestionably great fighters, but I'm wondering if, like, Cuba now is starting to look like a place where maybe we could have some pro fights.
Well, I can answer that for you because we talk about that regularly. Luis would love that. Luis now is a fan favorite in Cuba. It seems to be even the Cubans are switching their opinion on what boxing is, and we talk about that regularly here where nobody really goes at the end of the day to a Yankee Stadium or a baseball stadium to see the outfielder or the shortstop. People go see the home run hitter. And he knows he's getting a lot of fan mail, a lot of calls from people in Cuba. And he would love to want to go fight there because he thinks he'll be a superstar over there. He just hopes the time is right, and then it's up to the United States and Cuba being able to fix it and Golden Boy. And I know they would love to take him there. But he talks about that regularly because it's
and obviously from us, from our side on Golden Boy, I mean, it's something that we've discussed many times. And, you know, what better than to take a heavyweight Cuban heavyweight champion back to fight in his home country, and we would love nothing better than to do
absolutely
that. And I think the race is on. Obviously, what's transpired in the last year between the both countries, it's a move in the right direction. And you know, and the race is on between promoters, who's going to do the first fight in Cuba. And that's something that we've talked about, and Oscar's for it 100%. And we would love to go back with Luis. And, you know, he's the hero, the big hero, the first ever heavyweight champion out of Cuba going back home to fight in his own country.
Our next question comes from Lamar McCaster from HoopJab.
Hello, everybody, and thank you for having me. I have two questions. First question can be answered by either King Kong or the trainer. And second one is directed directly towards Luis Ortiz. Other than your power, what advantages do you think you bring into this fight against Bryant Jennings that you could exploit and come out with the victory, especially with him being with a new trainer in John David Jackson, you know, his first camp out?
Well, I think that being your first point that I would bring up, him switching trainers in a big fight as well. So that's something that we're going to exploit. And then the second thing is Luis's, you know, his technique is, like I said a few minutes ago, he's seen it all in the ring. There's absolutely nothing that Jennings is going to be able to do that will shake him, startle him, surprise him, get him out of his game plan, where I don't believe Jennings has the same and can say the same. So there are things that Luis will do that he will and hasn't been able to prepare for. And so I think that in a sense is the main topic there, is that we're just going to do what we do a little bit better, a little bit harder, a little bit longer. And him, you know, Jennings swapping trainers, I can't say that the chemistry may not be there immediately, because sometimes you do click, coach, and sometimes you do click instantly. But there is that gap, and unfortunately, I don't know that you can bridge it in 6 weeks. So that may or may not be a factor. It could just be, you know, wishful thinking. But at the end of the day, it's going to be just Luis doing what Luis does. That is the difference.
Okay, thank you. And the second question is for Luis. Okay, and the second question is for Luis. With all the chaos in the heavyweight division, you know, there's reports of Tyson Fury being stripped of the IBF belt and, of course, his rematch clause with the Vladimir. If you can't secure a fight against any of the other champions in the division, would you be interested in facing perhaps Ruslan Chagaev to take the interim label off your title with the WBA?
Que si todo lo que está pasando ahora en lo que es peso completo, obviamente está desafío ganándole a Klitschko y la revancha de ellos, ahora están negociando la revancha de ellos y quizás se puede demorar mucho tiempo. Si usted no puede inmediatamente después de esta pelea, obviamente ganando esta próxima pelea, si usted no puede hacer algo en esa división con ellos, que si usted tuviera cualquier sala contraria, si pelear con él.
No, yo estoy listo, yo estoy listo, yo lo mío es pelear por los cinturones, por llegar a tener yo peleo con Sagrada, con cualquiera, lo mío es tener los cinturones del mundo en mis manos. Yo siempre espero por mi marcha y el bottom board que me ponga a la gente adelante y es como que me lleva mi carrera. No me interesa el dinero, sino traer los cinturones del mundo para aquí.
Well, he says that he wants to fight well with the fight, that what he wants is about. And he maybe feels that it's about if they don't want to fight him, they avoid him. That anyway, the fighter brings the money. Sometimes it's not the belt. He thinks that he's going to bring the money to he's going to bring the fan base. And he walks the belts, and if they avoid him, then there's nothing he could do except to Golden Boy to get in the fights. But he thinks he's gonna start filling the stadiums.
Okay, thank you, gentlemen.
We have a question from Sean Crows from Boxing Insider.
Hi, yes, it's very nice to speak to you today. I just have pretty much one simple question. Are you comfortable with how Jennings will come at you? Or do you feel that maybe he has learned he's going to try new things after being in the ring with someone like Vladimir Klitschko? He did well against him, obviously not well enough. Do you think he may have tweaked his style between then and now? Or are you just simply prepared for anything?
Viendo Jennings, sabiendo como él hizo con Klitschko, si tú opinas que él va a cambiar o va a ser bien contra ti, o si él te molesta pensando que si esto va a tener problemas.
No, somos dos boxeadores diferentes, dos peleadores diferentes y los dos hacemos cosas diferentes. Y mi trabajo es diferente. Yo voy a salir a destruir a mi oponente que toque la rumba.
Besides, him and Crystal are two different people. He thinks a lot of people know that. He thinks Jennings knows that especially. Luis is coming out from the bell ring to fight. The difference, one of the biggest differences between boxing and softball is that Luis hits a lot harder than Klitschko. So don't compare them, he says. We're nothing alike. Me and Klitschko are nothing alike, he says. Thank you.
Okay, well, it's a good pairing. You just throw it out there. Okay, thanks.
Thank you.
Okay, Luis, thank you so much for your time. Luis, muchas gracias por tu tiempo hoy. ¿Nos puedes dar unas últimas palabras sobre tu pelea de lo que quieres que la prensa sepa?
Bueno, que yo tengo en mi mente bien clara que yo voy a ser campeón del mundo. Y que todo aquel que se pare, que se ponga en mi camino por llegar a mis cinturones, lo voy a destruir. Ese es mi trabajo. Muchas gracias por haberme
entrevistado. Jay, do you want to translate that?
Thank you. You guys need a translation for that or not?
Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
He says thank you very much for the interview and that his job is to fight. His job is to destroy whoever comes and tries to come for him and dares to step in the ring to take his money from his family. This is what he does for a living. Thank you very much, and God bless
you. Thank you. Thank you, Luis. Thank you, Jay, for helping translate. Eric, go ahead, and let's turn over the call to Team Jennings.
Great, thank you. Thank you, Jay, for translating. I know it can be tough. Thank you very much, and Luis, can't wait to see you in a couple of weeks, and I know you're training hard, so we'll be with you when you arrive in New York. Now I want to turn it over to our partner and good friend, Gary Shaw. You know, this fight was, it was very simple, very, very simple to make, because, you know, Gary's always interested in making great fights, and that's what, you know, that's what we're trying to do here at Golden Boy. So our interests are aligned, and I just want to thank Gary for everything, and it's going to be great to be working with Gary again. So I want to turn it over to Gary Shaw to say a few words. Gary.
Thank you very much. I appreciate what you said. I feel the same way about Golden Boy, and congratulations on Canelo's win. It was certainly a great win, and you have the star in the sport right now. So I congratulate you for that. I listened with interest on the Ortiz call. You talked about bringing him back to Cuba as the champion. I don't think that'll happen, but Jennings and I will be owning the first casino in Cuba, so we'd like to invite Ortiz to be our guest and Golden Boy when we won't come over the island. And the other thing I heard with interest was that they compared him to baseball and he's a home run hitter. But if you look at all the records, all the home run hitters strike out the most. And on December 19th, Ortiz is going to strike out. If anybody's underestimating Bryant Jennings, they're making a very, very bad mistake and a bad decision. Changing trainers was done for the benefit of Bryant Jennings. I was in the camp myself on Wednesday, I guess yesterday. They have a very good, healthy relationship. They're clicking as trainer and boxer, which is important. Edward Jackson is a great strength and conditioning coach, and he's in there with Jennings. And we don't talk smack. Jennings doesn't talk smack. Whatever he's going to do in the ring on December 19th. And Brian is a great speaker, and he can speak for himself. So at this point, if Brian wants to make some opening comments, that's fine. And if not, we can go right to the questions. Again, it's great to be working with Golden Boy. It's an honor for me.
Yeah, I'm here.
And, go ahead, Brian.
I'm here, and I'm pretty much just you know, I was listening as well. You know, he says what he's supposed to say. You know, he's the one that's going for, you know, he's the one that's in this match with me. And he has every right to protect himself and have full confidence and belief in himself, in his training camp, in his condition, and in his style. But, you know, I just beg to differ as the opponent, and that's when the round of questions will come for us, and we'll answer them to our best enough. So let's get it.
Okay, so let's get the questions if there are any.
Thank you. As a reminder, if you'd like to ask a question, please press star 1 on your touchtone phone. We have a question from Lucas Biggers from Heavy Bag.
Hi, thank you for having me on. I wanted to ask right away, I know Ortiz has a really high knockout ratio. Do you think your best course of action is to stay away from him and take him into the late rounds?
Okay, that's a question for me. What was Klitschko's knockout ratio? Very high against very good opponents. I just don't believe in the opponents that, you know, Luis Ortiz has faced, and I don't think that you can pretty much credit that ratio when you're in this top level of boxing. I don't think that any of that matters. I stated earlier in an interview that I did, I said this is Ortiz's first fight. This is his first real fight. And if you go down the line of his resume, then you will see no other fighter that could even come close to a person of my stature, even in this top, even at this level of boxing. So this is Ortiz's first real fight as a professional.
Thank you. I agree there. He doesn't really have, you know, that kind of experience as you do, of course. But my second question would be, how do you feel your training has been different with the new trainer of John David Beck?
Well, the training, of course, has been different, but it hasn't been difficult. You know, it's just been things that, you know, it's just like you taking one. If you're building a machine, and you know there's this person that's, you know, putting the wheels and the gears on the machine, and then okay, after that person puts the wheels and the gears on, his job is done. So you send it up to the people to polish it and get it ready for display. And that's the point I'm at in my career with John. And you know, John puts the polishing touches on it and put it up for display. Even throughout at the end of my career, everybody would take credit for the building and for the ability that I've possessed over my whole career. But at this point right here, this change is the polishing and set up for display, and we're gonna go out and we're gonna show you, you know, the differences and the upgrades that this training addition has placed.
All right. Thank you very much and good luck.
Yep. Thank you.
We have a question from Dan Raphael from ESPN.
Thanks very much. Hello, Bryant.
Hey, what up, Dan?
Thanks. Everything is good. Here's a question for you. I'm sure you watched, or maybe you didn't watch, but I'm sure you've heard that Vladimir Klitschko lost the titles to Tyson Fury last Saturday. You were the opponent that fought him in the previous fight, and you had, even though you didn't win the fight, you know, most people viewed the fight as, you know, Bryant Jennings, you know, did pretty well in that fight. I'm wondering, when you look at what happened in your fight, and then you look what happened in the fight with Tyson Fury, do you think you sort of started the beginning of the end and that he finished off what you started, or do you have a different view of the way that went down?
You know, even though the topic of this discussion is, you know, for me versus Ortiz, but, you know, I'll take your question.
I'll get to Ortiz in a minute.
I got you. But, yeah. But no, I just think that something is probably wrong with Klitschko on the inside. I think that he's going through something mentally. And, you know, that'll even take away from the ability that I put forth in the fight with me and him. But still, I just think it's something's going there. It's not there. And if you've seen a little bit of it in me and his fight, then you've seen all of it in the fight with him and Fury, because something is definitely wrong.
Now, as it relates to your fight with, your fight on the 19th with Ortiz, mm-hmm. as you said, you consider this to be his first real fight. You fought mm-hmm. Vladimir Klitschko, who's been the best heavyweight in boxing for the last decade plus. You've had some other fights mm-hmm. against, you know, good, solid opponents also. I mean, how much of an advantage do you think that gives you against somebody like Ortiz, even though he comes from that tremendous amateur background and has, you know, what most people would perceive as, you know, tremendous punching power?
Tremendous. Like I said, we're gonna elaborate on that tremendous punching power.
But what I'm just saying, your experience level compared to his as a professional.
Yeah, okay. Well, it's different. You look at, you know, he has a long amateur career. He has a long, talented amateur career. I have a talented professional career. You got guys at the collegiate level that, you know, that wins Heisman trophies, national championships. And when you go to the NBA or the NFL, there's a whole different story. You can't take from what you did from over there and bring it into this professional level. I mean, you can brag about it as prior accomplishments in your life and in that sport, but it's not going to win you a Super Bowl. It's not going to win you an NBA championship. So in this aspect of this boxing thing, you know, just because you're deep and experienced and amateur doesn't mean that, you know, you're going to be the best professional. Now, I know what it's like to lose. I know what it's like to be the underdog. I know what it's like to get hit. I know what it's like to have to fight hard, you know, for the decision, you know, by coming close to, you know, winning a split decision with Mike Perez, and kind of not feeling well during the fight and things like that, happened to really fight out of that. This guy hasn't really seen a real fighter, so therefore he can only go back to what he dominated, which was the amateurs, which was probably 20 years ago. The guy's 36 years old, and then you look at the fact that okay, he had steroid use. Why must a person that's as confident as he sounds as he is need to be able to enhance himself with any drugs? So therefore, you have a confidence issue with this person. So coming into this fight, he has to big himself up. He has to make himself believe that he knows exactly what he's doing, which he doesn't. And saying come, he has to prove it. You know, he has to prove it come the 19th. And if he doesn't prove it, then that'll shut him down completely, and that's my plan.
Okay, and I have another question for you on that, about just the level of the fight. I mean, because this is an HBO main event, and it's a name fighter like yourself, you know, this was going to get some attention anyway. But being that it's really the first fight in the heavyweight division of any kind of significance since the big upset between Tyson Fury and Klitschko, there'll probably be even more attention on it. And I'm wondering where you think that this fight puts you guys in the scope of the heavyweight division, you know, given its proximity to the big upset. A lot of people are paying attention to it.
Yeah. Well, you know, it features two talented individuals, and in the heavyweight division, two top ranked, you know, individuals, and you know, it just brings a different type of attention, because you know, people would say, okay, well, the fight last week was, you know, it was BS. So let's see what these guys have to offer. These are the next guys up, and you know, I'm quite sure that they're definitely going to see something. And I'm hoping that Ortiz, you know, definitely, you know, backs up everything that he says to be able to bring a tough fight. And you know how I go. I'm neutral. You know, I work hard, but I understand the possibilities in boxing. And I just know that for sure we're going to bring a good fight, and that the people will definitely be attracted to it. So we're going to put on this show and make sure that either one of us, you know, win, lose, or draw, you know, would be a main attraction, and all that momentum from the BS from last week will shift to us as positive momentum.
Did you watch that fight live last week, Bryant?
Yeah, I watched the fight live last week, and I was throwing up.
Because it was so boring?
It was, oh my God, it was the worst fight in heavyweight history. I swear to God, it was the worst fight in heavyweight champion history.
All right, Gary, could you address that real quickly also, just about the fact that, you know, like I said earlier, this was going to be a significant fight regardless, just given its the spotlight it's under on HBO as a main event. But because of its closeness to the big upset, and there's been a lot of talk now in the heavyweights because of what happened with Fury and Klitschko, where do you see this fight and what it can do for the guy that wins? If it's even a little more entertaining, let's say, than the Klitschko-Fury fight.
Well, it's definitely best, yeah. It's going to definitely be more entertaining. I believe Bryant's going to win this fight. But even if Ortiz won the fight, either Ortiz or Bryan would be Tyson Fury. He, in my estimation, is not a heavyweight champion, but it shows you the state of where Klitschko is. And I do agree with what Bryan said. It may not be that his talent deteriorated so much in two fights, but I think mentally he may not be there. And as a fighter, Bryan could speak to it, but if you're not mentally there, like any athlete, then that's a major problem. But I think that the winner of this fight will be recognized, I know how you feel about interim championships, but either one of these guys will be a number one in the boxing industry.
Gotcha. Look, I mean, interim title or not, it's an old-fashioned matchup between two good contenders that should be solid. Anyway, I thank you for your comments, Gary, and also you too, Bryan. Wish you guys good luck next week, or 2 weeks.
Thank you.
Right, you're welcome.
All right.
As a reminder, if you have a question, please press star 1. We have a question from John Kittley from the New York Examiner.
Hey, Bryan, how you doing?
Hey, what's going on?
What's up, man? Hey, listen, based on what I'm hearing from you, it seems like you feel Ortiz is a overhyped, unproven commodity in the heavyweight division, and that really is just a matter of his last performance that's got people all excited about. Are you preparing for the toughest fight of your life or the most dangerous fight of your life, or do you see this as a guy that is really a marginal talent that you can get out of there? Because he says he's coming to knock you out. How do you really feel about this?
Well, yeah, I always prepare for the toughest fight. And that's just, and see, but you asking me that question is only in response to what he said. He said he's coming to knock me out. If you hear any of my, you know, pre-fight suggestions on any of my fights, I never say what's going to happen. Even in this interview just now, I respected the possibility of losing and winning and a draw, you know. So, you know, this is boxing. So all that, he's confident,
what he's alluded to, overconfident, and he doesn't understand the fight that he's actually in. He hasn't faced nobody like me, and whether it was me or somebody else that's just as close or in the top 10, you know, I mean, which one of his top 10 fighters did he fought? You know,
right.
I would wait. I can wait. I will wait till 5 o'clock. Just name me one. I will wait. He hasn't.
So well, he hasn't.
You know, this guy has to put in. You know, he has to humble himself because it's going to be an embarrassment. You know, and me, I play it safe. I'm always politically correct. You get what I'm saying? I work hard, and I know what it is. It's a heavyweight division. These guys are skilled. These guys are strong, and one punch can take you out. But what I do is I practice and I make sure that I'm well-conditioned, I'm well-trained, and that I go in and I get my 100%. My 100% might not be good enough for Ortiz, but guess what? It's my 100%. So therefore, I'm going to speak and I'm going to give my 100%, and that's what the fans will love, my 100%. You can't expect 120 or 200%. You know, I'm giving my 100. That's what you love me for. I'm giving my all, my 100. That's it, but I'm never going to over-talk myself. I'm never going to be over, you know, be too cocky, sound all crazy, because I understand that in this game, you better watch out. He better watch out, because I'm standing my ground. That's what I do. I'm on defense. I'm standing my ground. And he needs to watch out. Watch his tone. You know, watch his mouth. You know, don't be over cocky, because I have you crying in the ring. You're going to be crying. You know what I'm saying? So, you know, just it's going to be real difficult for him to get over. You know, he might want to beat up his whole corner. You know what I'm saying? He might want to go, you know, snap. You know what I mean? But just telling him, you know, calm down, because they're not telling him something. They're not telling him something. You know, they're pumping him up. You know, they putting all this gas in him. You know, he going to blow. You know what I'm saying? And this is what it's going to be on December 19th, because I'm coming to fight, and I'm coming to give my all. And if he think his all is within his mouth and not his hand, then he got another fight coming.
Hey, real quick, Brian, specific to you and John David Jackson, have you seen something in Ortiz specifically that you can exploit in a couple of weeks?
Why would we
Well, listen here, Gary. It's something that's obvious. It's very obvious. The guy once used steroids in a division that's not... Listen, I've always said to everybody, And pretty much early in my career, I said, listen, I wish I was living in the days of the good heavyweight division era. You know, because that's how much I want to test myself. If you ask my trainer, if you ask John right now, if you ask Jack right now, am I willing to test myself? Do I push myself to the limit? And they're going to say, hell yeah. So this is something that I want to do. So therefore, I want to use my natural ability to push myself to the limit to really see where I stand. But me, if somebody using, you know, performance enhancement, and it's like, you got to cheat in this era? Are you crazy? This era? This era is bullshit. You know, and it's like, we work hard, blood, sweat, and tears. And that's why I'm connected with, you know, old school guys, you know, guys that really know the game, that really know the sport, that really knows what it's like, that really been in them trenches, you know, that really, you know, worked in the gym with one bag and no pads and a broken ring. You know, I love that. That's the grittiness of it. And this is what I do. I don't cheat the game. I play fair. So, you know, just like in basketball, they say the ball don't lie. We're going to see December 19th.
Well, let me just add to that so that all the press knows. For this fight, we are doing drug testing. VADA is doing the testing.
VADA.
Something that Golden Boy... agreed to. There was no problem on either end of drug testing. Bryant Jennings is a vegan. They can test him 24/7. But I do want to take this platform in just a second to say that for the sake of our sport and for the betterment of our sport, and I think that's where Brian is going as well, we need to drug test everyone all the time and prove to the public that we're a clean sport, and that the two warriors that go in there in that ring and sometimes place their life on the line and sometimes have given up their life are clean. So we are drug testing for this fight, and I wish everyone else for all their fights would drug test. Money is the wrong thing to say that holds back drug testing in boxing. I appreciate the platform. Thank you.
Our next question comes from Rick Sikkens from Bleacher Report.
Brian, I'm wondering, you're kind of a late start in boxing, but it seemed like the last few years, to my eyes, you look like you've gotten better as you started to move up and fight guys that were ranked up higher, much higher in the division. So I'm wondering if you feel like you're still, you know, if you're still reaching your peak, even though you're, you know, 30 or so, if you still feel like you've got more room to develop into even better.
I feel 19, though. I feel 19 years old.
But 30 is the new 19.
Yeah. 30 is the new 19. I think I'm still progressing. I think I still have, you know, some time left. And the most important thing in doing this sport and in doing any sport is, you know, taking care of yourself and keeping a clear head and having a clear conscience and a clear mentality. You know, therefore you could be able to, you know, operate well. And that's one of the things that I focus on. And, you know, on top of me still feeling youthful and me still putting in hard work, yes, I think I still haven't even reached, you know, my best yet.
All right, thanks a lot.
You're welcome.
We have a question from Glenn Irby from Black Sports Online.
Hey, Brian, thanks for taking my call today.
Hey, no problem, man.
The question, I know, you know, in sports, sometimes a loss can catapult a team, catapult a player to, you know, heights beyond their, you know, beyond their dreams. Do you feel like even though you lost your last fight, it was a catapult to something bigger? Do you feel like you got a win out of it and you got a different aspect on how you want to approach things from here on out? Because I see bigger things for you, you know, because of that experience alone, win or lose.
You know, some of the greatest fighters in history have a loss. And I think that loss for me wasn't a real loss. That L, I'm saying, wasn't a loss. It was a learning experience
okay.
for me. And of course, it's something that it teaches you how to feel when you're defeated or when you didn't come up with the win. So therefore, it conditions your mentality to say, okay, to the point where I know what a loss feels like. So therefore, it don't really feel that bad. But, you know, you still want to win. So that actually makes it more dangerous. This guy knows what a loss feels like, but yet he still wants to win. But he don't want to lose no more. So he fights hard enough to still win. And the other fighter don't know how that loss feels. So therefore, he might get some comfortability in himself and say, I'm never going to lose. I'm never going to do this. I'm never going to do that. And we may catch him slipping.
So we basically have a new and improved Bryant Jennings off his first disappointment.
I mean, yeah. I mean, you definitely have a different Bryant Jennings. Tomorrow I'll be new and improved from today.
Right.
You know, every day is a progress. You know, so therefore, you know, I'm better than I was yesterday. So tomorrow is always going to be a new and improved. So it's not. All right, take care, y'all. It's not something to where though it's like, okay, well, oh, since he lost, you know, he's new and improved. That's just putting too much expectation on things. I'm new and improved every day. Every single day that passes, I'm new and improved. So therefore, you will see, you know, a different Brian. It's been so long. I learned so much from the Klitschko fight, like mentally and about life, and you know about things, about people, about the business. Boxing, shit, it makes it easy for me because I'm going back to that, you know, that clear thinking, that mentality that I have on life. You know, it's different, man. And if Ortiz can figure out something, you know, in his head, you know, about this life thing, he's gonna look at it a whole lot different. You know, because he's coming from a country where he had to escape. You know, and they still don't understand why they even had to leave and why they would come to America and why they would think America would be better than there. And after a certain period of time, they may say, okay, I want to go back and say, have you learned the difference or have you learned the reason why you wanted to leave? So, you know, it's just a different thing with life period. So, you know, I'm new and I'm improved in all different aspects.
Excellent answer. Thank you again, Brian.
You're welcome.
We have a question from Albert Baker from Instant Boxing.
Hey, Brian. So,
hey, what's up?
So, you know, we've been getting press releases showing that you're fighting 15 rounds and you're looking spectacular.
As I always do.
Now, I mean, you got a body that looks like it was chiseled out of marble. You're a great athlete, but do you worry about maybe leaving it in the ring and overtraining ahead of the fight?
No, that's why I'm that's why I'm with, you know, top tier trainers and things like that. You know, we know when to hold and we know when to fold and we know when to pick it up and things like that, and that's what makes the trainers great.
Now, Brian, you're a good interview and you're a good talker. Do you think that with a victory over Ortiz, that might be a platform for you to maybe get on some more TV? One of the things the heavyweight division's been missing for a long time, we don't see them on the late shows no more, the heavyweight contenders, the title holders, or anything like that. Do you think maybe they need or you would like to market yourself a little bit better after this and hey, because you have the character that could do it?
Yeah, well, if people go to my Instagram at @BYJennings, I market myself all day. It's only people only pay attention to what they want to pay attention to, and what they know that they can control. If somebody knows that they can't control a certain thing, they're going to go around it. It's called politics. They're going to go around it. They're going to overlook it. I've always been this person since the NBC days, NBC Sports days. You know, I was promised a commentating job, you know, or commentating opportunity. You know, even way back then, that was 2012. You know, I always felt as though I had the look, I had the face, I had the body, I had the persona. You know, I had the professionalism. You know, that's way overdue. You know, but it's just like somebody has to point that out, and somebody has to get behind it, and somebody has to believe in it. But they don't believe in it because of, you know, of somebody else that they're actually gassing up, and they just, I don't know what it is. Maybe it's just because they can control them in a certain aspect. But, you know, it's just not me. You know, even though I feel as though I'm definitely a person for that type of job, but it's just not me who they're looking for. And they get who they're looking for. They push who they want to push. They put in front who they want to put in front. You got to even look at my fights. It's just like, wow, I don't even know what it feels like to fight somebody that's 32-10. And been knocked out 4 times. You kidding me? I don't know what that feel like. I don't know what it feel like to fight somebody, you know, with 5 losses within my last 8 fights or whatever. Like, you know, it's just like, wow, I don't get those type of opportunities. You say, why me? Why the person that has the best face, the best body, the best professionalism, why does he have to be put in situations like that? Why? Because I got to prove myself. And when I get there, you either respect me or I don't respect the game at all. That's how it's going to be. I'm putting my work in. You know how they say, you got to put your work in before you talk? I'm putting my work in, and I'm not talking yet. So that's why I'm not where you asked me or where I should be at.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
We have a question from Sean Crows from Boxing Insider.
Okay.
You know what? My question has previously been answered. All the best, Bryant, and thank you very much.
What was the question?
What's that?
What was the question? Come on, don't just get on and say, oh, it's been answered. What's the question?
Listen, we'll get in there. My question was answered. It was the same one that I asked Luis Ortiz, which was said that you had learned so much from the Klitschko fight. That's what I wanted to know. How much have you learned from it? You read about, like, I remember Gene Tunney saying he could have been a great fighter had he not lost one. How much do you think you've learned from the experience?
Well, you asking me now? You thought you said it was answered. You asking me again?
Listen, if you're willing to answer, I'm going to write it down. No.
Yeah, like I said, man, I learned a lot. I learned a lot about life and different aspects. You know, was able to sit down and think. But, you know, the more so, it wasn't really about, the majority of the things I learned wasn't really about me and boxing. You know, it's about me and life, my purpose. And, you know, the ups and downs with the relationships, ins and out politics, you know, ways that the world works, and, you know, kind of, like I said, kind of my purpose. So that's more so what I learned, and it made me a more clearer person, more open person, and it's just pretty much paying off through the way I operate, how I do business, how I conduct business, how I talk to my people, you know, you know, how we, you know, how I work on getting everybody together and, you know, doing things. So it made me more professional and made me look at life a lot different. And, you know, it definitely made me push harder because, you know, I knew that I should have won that fight. So like, dang, like if only I could have done this. And this is one of the reasons why the trainer trade has, you know, has come into place. It's like, you know what? If I would have had this, then maybe it would have been working. So, you know, it's like, okay, this person that took me just as far as I can go, it's time for an upgrade. So therefore, that's when, you know, the training change came in about. And, you know, it was nothing that was stressed. It was just like a sweet transition, you know, just jump right over and, you know, come right over to this operation. You know, me and my previous trainer, you know, we still have a good relationship. He understands that it's business. You know, he took it kind of hard. But, you know, it's just the game, it's the business, and that's what we got to do, so.
Well, you know what? I'm glad you gave me the opportunity to ask again. Thanks a lot. I appreciate it.
All right, you're welcome.
And the last question comes from Gail Falkenthal from Communities Digital.
Thank you, Brian. Earlier you mentioned that you would like to have been part of the great era of boxing heavyweights, that's what you're trying to bring back. What do you think it is going to take to bring back a great new era in the heavyweight division today? What needs to happen?
Oh, man, that's great. That's a great question. You know, I think, who was it, Michael J. Fox that was Back to the Future? I think you need to bring, I think we need to rebuild the time machine and everybody just jump in it and, you know, just go back. Because other than that, I don't think it could be done. I just think that, you know, the world is changing. People's perspectives are changing. You know, religion is getting less powerful. So therefore, you know, people's morals and everything is just fading. And money is, the greed for money is rising. People don't stand for nothing nowadays. So, you know, everybody's doing it for a different reason. And the real genuineship and the real human being is just it's just losing. It's going. And that's why I surround myself around good people. That's why I love good people. I like good people having good relationships and just exercising the mentality that I know, that I grew up off of. And that's what it is. So this world is even it's happening in everything. It's happening in music. It's happening in boxing. It's happening in art. It's happening in all sports. It's happening on TV. Everything is degrading because of the way that people are viewing life now, and it's just generation after generation after generation, and it's just getting lower and lower and lower and lower and lower, and it's we're not in a good state.
Knowing all of that and knowing how hard mm-hmm. then that is for you as an individual human being to do all those things, does it encourage mm-hmm. you? Does it make you work harder at that, or do you ever feel discouraged about it?
Shit, if I feel discouraged, I might as well go grab a rope. No, it encouraged me to keep forward and keep pushing. Shit, yeah, keep pushing. You know, I can't. I mean, I see it, and I know that. I know that's what's wrong with it, but I'm not going to become a part of the problem. You know, I just take advantage of the time that I have here on this earth, teach my son, you know, teach everybody that's around me, you know, the good traits and how I was raised, and, you know, a good way to be, you know, a good way to be taught. And, you know, we just keep separating ourselves, you know, it may only be 10 of us, you know, but we just keep separating ourselves and we live the traditional way. We live the way that we know how we live it, and we don't never let nobody change that. So I'm always encouraged, never discouraged about life.
Thank you, Brian. Thanks for what you do inside and outside the ring, and good luck on the 19th.
All right. Thank you. You're welcome.
All right. Thank you so much, Gail, for that last question. Brian, do you have any final words that you want to say to the press that are still on this call?
Oh, well, I thank all press for, you know, taking the opportunity to either listen or to ask questions. And I just want people to, you know, pay a little more close attention to the people that you have in front of you. And, you know, take more credit for, you know, picking a better person, better people to make this sport a better sport, because this is your jobs, and your jobs includes your life. Your life includes your family, and your family includes your history and your generation. So, you mean, you always make the right decisions. You know, be smarter and do what you got to do.
Thank you, Brian.
And see y'all on the 19th.
No, I just actually want to thank everybody. Thank HBO. Congratulate Peter Nelson, by the way, on his appointment, new appointment at HBO. And my final words are that I'm proud to represent Bryant Jennings. I'm proud to represent a clean athlete inside and outside the ring, a family man, and will be the new champion on December 19th. Thank you all.
Thank you, Gary. Eric Gomez, any final words on Golden Boy side?
Yes, thank you. I want to thank Gary Shaw for being a great partner, and obviously HBO as well. Once again, tickets. Get your tickets at priced really low, $25, $35, and $60 for ringside. They're available again at Ticketmaster.com, or you can call 315-361-7469, and that's the box office there at Turning Stone. Or if you can't be there to watch it live, you can watch it on HBO Boxing After Dark. The broadcast will start at 10:15 Eastern and Pacific. I just want to thank everybody. I can't wait, and hope to have you guys join us on December 19th. Thank you.
And thank you. I want to give a last thanks. Is it John on the line?
Yeah.
I'd like to thank John for, let's see, how long was this? You didn't get asked one question, you didn't have to say it. I'd like to thank you for holding on for about 35 minutes without having to say anything. You could have been on the phone though. You could have been playing your little crossword puzzle.
Bryant didn't answer any questions. He didn't have to do anything. His
final
work will show on December
10th. That's right.
Right.
Appreciate it, brother. Thank you.
Okay, everybody. Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. This concludes today's conference. We thank you for participating. You may now disconnect.
All right.
You had a conference?